I hope you're enjoying the symposium today. It's, as we mentioned, the 20th annual symposium, and we do, in addition to this symposium, many other educational events like our Ask the Expert series and DBS Ambassadors Program and others, and the ability to put on these educational events and other programs through our center is very dependent on support that we get, both from industry, but especially from private donations like many people have made today, and we greatly appreciate that. First, I want to thank again Stacy Lee, who we mentioned earlier, for her leadership in our Wellness Works program as a supporter and driver of the program is greatly appreciated. And there's many others who I won't take the time to thank now today who also have been a major part of that. But I also want to just make an announcement of another recent development at our Parkinson Center, which is a very generous donation that's going to come from Carolyn and George Rousseau, who've made a commitment for a very transformational gift to our center. This is not for the Parkinson Symposium that we've been collecting donations for today, but more for other programs, and especially the Wellness Works, among other research programs that we do at our center. And, many of you may know George if you're involved in Rocksteady Boxing or Boot Camp or Tai Chi or other wellness programs. He's very passionate about these programs and how they benefit patients, as you've heard some about that today. And part of his gift will establish the Rousseau Wellness Works Endowment, which will help sustain these programs forever through an endowment. And these programs are greatly needed to improve the lives of patients with Parkinson's disease, so we are greatly appreciative of this. And on behalf of the center, I want to personally thank George, who's here today in the front row here. So thank you very much, George. And now I would like to thank Dr. Kathleen Howland for agreeing to speak with us today. Dr. Howland is an educator, clinician, and a passionate advocate of the power of music to treat individuals and groups in meaningful ways for non-musical outcomes. As a speech-language pathologist and music therapist, she uses a broad range of interventions to leverage strengths against deficits in rehabilitation, treating functional skills in communication, cognition, and movement. She filmed a TED Talk in Spain and curates the website called Music Therapy Tales, which provides information through films about music therapy. And she lectures nationally and internationally and is an outstanding speaker with remarkably relevant expertise for our topic today. So again, we're very pleased to have her as our next speaker. Thank you.
Good afternoon. How are you all holding up? Good, because I bring good news to all of you about the power of arts, and particularly after what I've just seen, what a great testament to people with Parkinson's disease and the importance of creativity and flexibility to accompany the journey of Parkinson's. So I'm really pleased actually to just be down the road today. That works out really well. And we're going to start. I bridge the worlds of science and art to the benefit of both. So I got outside with Dr. Schlag and I said, Gottfried, I have a gift for you. I have this amazing person who had a few strokes and is in amusic, which means she can no longer perceive sound correctly. And she's an ear training teacher at a music college, right? Just the kind of thing. And she can continue her work. So we love to take a look at how arts and sciences inform one another. Thank you. What a wonderful staff here. Really great. So the question could be, why music? Why are we talking about music in particular? And with regard to Parkinson's disease, it's about movement, it's about articulation, it's about swallowing. Music for swallowing. How about that? And it's very dear to my heart about caregiver support. And I love the testimony you had for your husband. It was beautiful. So why music? Despite what is generally thought in the public, music is not given to talent. In fact, I don't care for that word anymore. I don't. At least 96% of the human population has normal aptitude for music. Perception and production. You could be on the average side, the above average, or the below average, but the people who are tone deaf and beat deaf are less than 4% of the entire population. And it's all about competency. It's all about nurture those natural aptitudes. Music is an inherited human trait. That's a whole other talk, but I gotta tell you, that's an exciting one. And music is the only thing we know that is diffusely activated throughout the brain. I can point to a language center. I can point to volitional movement of my right side. I can point to the visual cortex by which I am seeing your faces and registering your attentiveness. But I cannot point to a music center. There isn't one. It is diffusely activated, left, right, cortical, subcortical. It really is this amazing gift for us. And now they're looking at the necessity of having normal music perception in order to learn language, in order to develop cognition in children. This isn't some byproduct of our evolutionary past. This is central to optimal brain wiring. Because music does change the brain. And when somebody asked about learning an instrument at this age, well, you can do it, but it takes a whole lot of effort, a lot more than if you were 7 or 8. So what if a proper music education educated everybody's aptitude optimally from K through 12, so that at this age, when you wanted to resume some of that, a lot of that network is still there? Yes, you would lose it, as Dr. Slog said, but you still have a fundamental basis and you're not starting from zero and you worked with developmental windows. What if that was the purpose of music education? And not going to Berkeley, because frankly, they're all gonna come anyhow. But what if everybody deserves the right to be connected to music as a place of joy, comfort, resilience across your lifespan? Then you would have access to all of this when you needed it. And with regards to movement, I titled my story after Oliver Sacks's works, From Kinetic Stutter to Kinetic Melody. And that works for gross motor movement, fine motor movement. And the other thing about music is it is fun. Is it not joyful? I mean, you can make it miserable, like, oh, that 30-second run. Oh, that was on my mind. You can do that, but why would you when there's so much beauty that you could honor? So music is fun and compelling and motivating. And here's part of its importance. If I asked you to repeat a motor pattern with a click, like you saw in Schlag's video, with just the click, and he's upright, his stride length was so much better, and he was in kinetic flow. If I blinked a light at you and you had to perform this motor task, or touched you, this was looked at, and what we see throughout here is that the auditory system is exceptionally well positioned to generate movement, to organize movement. And this is why metronomes do not have flashing lights, because the visual system is the worst. So there was this beautiful study that I love on dancing, and they were looking at ballroom dance versus tango in people with Parkinson's disease. And what they had were lessons twice a week, and they were measuring balance and functional mobility, all the tasks that are important to lifestyle, and found that both actually were very significant in changing balance and locomotion. And tango, which has a lot of backward movement and a lot of proximity to a partner, actually was slightly better in this. So you could be on a treadmill, or you could dance. So here's a film of my friend Pamela Quinn. This woman is a professional dancer in New York City, and she has Parkinson's disease. And she's brilliant. And what you're seeing is symptom-driven dance. This was at the World Parkinson's Conference.
What follows is a sampling of what we do in PD Movement Lab, a class where I explore different ways to help people with Parkinson's move. The class is dance-based, but symptom-driven. We wake up our bodies and our voices.
Oh, oh, oh!
We exaggerate our expressions. to counteract facial mask.
Oh, oh, oh. Oh? What?
What?
Ah, nothing. Come on. Tell me. They're in New York City.
And if we want to do something we can't manage safely on our own, like money, we find ways to adapt. We use imagery and intending to transform ourselves as if we're receiving more or acting like royalty.
Can we give this for Pamela?
Yes.
Beautiful, beautiful. When the sensibilities of art specialists are matched with neuroscientists, neuropsychologists, and neurologists, and driven by patient needs, that equals the best outcome. No one discipline owns truth, but together we can really create meaningful, functional work. I love this nodding, that's great. So as a speech-language pathologist, we often started by working with Parkinson's patients by working on articulation, getting your P's and your T's to be more distinct because of the dysarthria involved with Parkinson's. But then, of course, LSVT flipped the whole thing around and showed us so long as we breathe well, we can drive phonation and articulation and improve the outcomes, improve intelligibility. And the one thing that LSVT also found was that swallowing improved. So that was a huge gift because really for laryngeal issues, what we offer as speech pathologists is uncomfortable and a little bit awkward. And this, I think, is much more natural. So there are great outcomes with LSVT, and I'm also certified in LSVT. But if you've never seen what your vocal folds look like, I'd like to show you. And what you want to think about are the calisthenics of this little muscle system.
Here is a look at some normal young female vocal cords during a stroboscopic exam.
They're coming together. They're thicker. They're thinner, longer. And longer yet, with the changes in pitch. We'll get a glissando. Those are little vocal fold calisthenics. And by singing, you can actually bring the vocal folds together, which reduces the breathiness of the dysarthria. By bringing them together with loudness, you practice LSVT in music in ways that feel more natural than the repetition of single pitches. Who has done LSVT? Good. What I understand from my colleagues and from the research and training is that it tends to wane afterwards. So how many of you are still practicing with the video? Uh-oh. Okay. Practice without the video? How many people are practicing without the video? Okay, good. Not quite as many hands. But what if we had your music playlist? Would it be Harry Belafonte? Would it be my favorite Dino? Would it be Frankie? What would get you singing? Because you know what? It matters how you sing to go to Berkeley, but it doesn't matter how you sing to get better. Sing it out. Sing it loud. Get the job done and have some bloody fun doing it. So voice, choral singing has become, of course, really a wonderful resource for people with Parkinson's. You have the tremble clefs, of which I've gone to see. And what we see is that by bringing in the sensibilities of singers, you get the respiratory work that is so key with being able to sing. If you hear Renee Fleming, who is a personal favorite of mine and now a huge advocate for music therapy, she will always talk about how they sing without any microphone. They sing without any microphone. This is far easier. But they're taught how to do that. Well, let's bring that sort of work into people with Parkinson's because they have a wide variety of ways of getting you to breathe better, and that's going to drive the whole system better in the way that LSVT has brilliantly shown us. So in therapeutic choirs, you get that social affiliation, and I swear, no talent necessary. Again, I don't believe in talent. I believe in work. I believe in the gifts of nature, and I believe in the efforts of nurture to get optimal responses. But it really doesn't matter how you sing. If you're off pitch, then bloody sing it louder. You know? It also is an equalizing opportunity so that caregivers can be partners again with their spouses and not always taking care, watching out, thinking ahead. You can do this together. And you can have fun. At the same time as you saw with Pamela's work, you can work on gross motor, fine motor, and vocal skills all in the same activity. It's PTOTST all wrapped in together. And you're having some fun. So all therapeutic goals can be addressed. And again, it could be inclusive. Like why, as a Parkinson's tribe, do you hang out together and yet all the stroke patients hang out together but have many of the same symptoms? Like if it was really symptom-based, then you would conjoin with them. You would conjoin, we would all have people who have speech problems, dysarthria, in a choir, no matter what your etiology is, no matter what your diagnosis is. More is better. More is louder. More is more social. And you all deserve that. So I think it could be more inclusive and that, again, the joy comes in. And especially with long-term needs, there should be plenty of long-term joy to facilitate that. So I have an example of a Parkinson's choir in Florida. And although the song that they've written is really quite charming, I don't prefer it. And I want you to figure out why.
Good morning. Before you is the North Florida Parkinson's Awareness Choir in Tallahassee, Florida. We're here this morning presenting a song that was written by one of our members, Mr. Steve Sandler, and assisted by another member, a Olivia Swedberg. We are happy to perform this song for you. We think it is, it demonstrates our mission and what we do with our singing. And we think it would be helpful to all Parkinsonians everywhere and possibly become a theme song for us nationally. And now we'll sing the song for you. Thank you.
Perhaps you can identify the people with Parkinson's and the caregivers. Please watch the people sing with Parkinson's. So in the interest of time, I think that's a good enough sample. Can you guess why I don't prefer it? Well, I don't mind that they're singing about their limitations, and it's kind of clever, isn't it? You know, I could sit at home. Yes.
So they're talking about reaching for the sky, but they're not doing any kind of movement.
Movement would be good, but that's, as a speech therapist, that's not where I'm going. Yes. Ding, ding, and dingy, ding, ding. That the caregivers are carrying it and not the people with Parkinson's. The articulatory demands are too high. And so it's not setting them up for success. There's no place to breathe, and LSVT has taught us that's driving the system. This should be a place where the caregivers are not carrying the people that they care for. That it should be symptom-driven like the dance is, and that the music would absolutely do that. So when we choose the music, yes, it could be charming, yes, it could be seasonal, but is it symptom-driven? Does it allow the person with the most challenges to have some skin in the game? Because that's the person I want to calibrate any successful endeavor with. Because if I get that person singing, speaking, and coming in a functional way, then everybody else will flourish. And that's what I want. So well done. So for caregivers, just like on an airplane, the caregiver should take the oxygen first and then give it to the person who is their dependent. Music therapy, music-based interventions offers this, either by being in a program of movement or singing or both with your care partner or having a separate support system because you deserve the oxygen. If you're going to deliver care consistently for the long term, then everything you do for yourself is a mitzvah, is a gift to your partner. And we need to create more of these type of experiences, and perhaps in the next year we could look at arts that caregivers are doing in expressing themselves. It would be incredibly stress-reducing, and the stress that's caused by caregiving has gotten the attention of NIH, and many grants now come through with provisions for caregivers. So in summary, music, music, music provides social affiliation, the addressing of therapeutic goals, sometimes all at once. And of course, not only STPTOT type goals, but emotional goals, emotional support, wonderful dopamine surges and squirts through your system when you're singing music. It's also a point of resilience. It's a place, a touchstone, a song that you sing that gives you courage. When you walk through the storm, hold your head up high, and don't be afraid of the dark. is at the end of the storm. There'll be a golden sky in the sweet silver song of the lark. Walk on through the wind, walk on through the rain, though your dreams be tossed and blown. Walk on with hope in your heart, and you never walk alone. No, you never walk alone. May that be so. That song gave me courage every day I had to go for chemotherapy for 15 months. Everybody deserves a touchstone, a place of strength, a song that can create resilience. To bring you into flow, into kinetic flow. Enjoyment, aesthetic beauty, and meaning throughout this course, this unfortunate dance with Parkinson's, what will you do with this one sweet and wild life? There's so much more that's available than ever before. I trust in the arts, I trust in neuroscience, and you deserve it all. So I thank you for your kind attention.
Thank you very much. I think we have time for just a few questions. If
the questions are my favorite part. Good.
Which one? Who music was it with the group in New York? Oh, isn't that wonderful? It's an Indian artist named, what's the one who did Slumdog Millionaire? Yes,
no, give me a second.
Slumdog Millionaire, and I was in India for the Parkinson Society.
Yeah, give me.
Last January.
Excuse me.
Yes, sir.
I had a problem a little bit with talking. Mm-hmm. And I started exercising my voice. Mm-hmm. And I found out that I'm not stuttering as much and getting into the right place, which I have to exercise in the condominium, everybody can hear. So I go to the cemetery. I try to wake him up. And from talking the way I'm talking, I went into the right place. And now I couldn't do this before.
That's beautiful.
If you're a part of the choir, I say give him a solo. Any other questions? Yes, sir. So the question was, do the choral leaders pick the music? What I've seen time and time again when I've visited choirs around the world is the music choices are given to the music and not the therapeutic outcomes. So I think a collaboration with a specialist would always be in order to ensure that those functional goals are there, as well as the sensibilities of music, to be seasonal, to be really good quality music, that sort of thing. Yes, I believe in collaboration fully. Yes. Hi, my dear. Lovely.
So, Cinemac is wonderful. Cabadup and Lebedup was great. Therapists, we love them, all sorts. But person-centered treatment is free. And personally, when he starts having a symptom, instead of like, oh my God, here comes again, he uses a different mindset to say, you know, this is time to sing, this is time to dance. So when he has a symptom, we just don't, doesn't matter where we are, we just dance it out. And when his voice gets projected, when he picks a song that he likes, that he loves soft, he loves rock and roll. So we turn it up as high as it can go, and I tell him to, I want to hear you, I don't want to hear the song. So that helps him project, and it helps him move through the symptoms even faster. We don't want it to be destined or determined by the medication that he takes. Yeah. We got to own it.
It's great to work with the medicine to bring in all these other sensibilities. And if you're not aware of the whole field of positive psychology, she just gave a beautiful example of all those sensibilities. How do you increase optimism? How do you feel badly and then get the job done anyhow? Right? So the field of positive psychology is the science of happiness. It's a course I teach at Berkeley. How fun is this? Right? We talk about forgiveness and optimism, stress and nirvana, all of these topics. And if anybody wants to come and visit one of those classes, I invite you to contact me through BI, and they will put you in touch with me, and you can come and sit and share your wisdom as an elder with these undergraduates as well, because you're walking the walk and living it. So it would be my delight to invite you to Berkeley, where you can walk around that neighborhood singing and nobody ever looks, because everybody's singing. Thank you very much.